Is it a struggle? Yes, we have to realize our strengths and our weaknesses. Welcome to Why Not with Janice, and I'm your host, Janice. Today we have a special guest. Our topic today is managing the stress of COVID-19 with children and teenagers. I think right now, because of COVID-19 and sheltered in place, there's a lot of people that they're having issues with their teenagers, and I feel this would be very important that we could discuss this topic. So today my guest is in the studio is Anthony Ward Jr., LCPC. He's a clinical therapist. He's going to talk to us today about this topic, okay? Welcome to the show, Anthony.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So with COVID-19 right now, the kids have been sheltered in place since March 20th. A lot of kids still aren't going out. How do you think first that that's affecting teenagers right now and kids? They're not socializing. They're not in school. What's that effect on kids?
Well, I think just the human animal is one that likes things to be predictable. And when you have unpredictability, if you don't know what your structure is going to be like to your day, you have higher anxiety. So I think our kids are anxious to know what's next. And most young people don't like transitions in the first place. So I'm just thinking of, I have a four-year-old and a two-year-old. When it's time to transition from bed, I mean, transition from whatever play time down to bed, I mean, they're going to kind of freak out on you. So I think even with teenagers, though we may not see literal breakdowns or tantrums, although you might see that as well, right. Just the anxiousness of the transitions and not knowing what's coming up next is really big for them. I think the other thing to think about as well is the transference of stress that comes from parents. So when parents are stressed, children are sponges of that. They experience those things with them as well. So I think we can actually see young people being more stressed as well as a result of seeing their parents stressed. But I think at least those two things are the things that's playing out on all of us, is the shared stress, the shared anxiety. And I think young people who don't have as much of a say in their world, they are being told what to do next all the time. And if nobody knows what to do next, they just experience that stress with less self-efficacy. Like, I can't change what I'm feeling. I can only experience what the parents or the older people are doing. So I would imagine that the anxiety is even higher for them because they don't have a say. They don't have the control over what does happen.
Okay, that makes sense. And I think, yeah, parents, they don't have a control. They have to do whatever their parents say. And the parents are having to feel anxious and not in the control because the government's telling them what to do. So it's like everyone has no clue what to do, and that's putting a lot of anxiety on everyone and frustration. So if kids are having all this anxiety, what type of tips, I mean, let's go into some tips real quick that parents can address the children's fears and their anxiety over this pandemic. I mean, what do they do? Do they have to describe to kids what's going on? I mean, what are they going to do? I mean, this has never happened since 1918, you know, hasn't happened since then. How do parents address the kids' fears and anxieties?
Yeah, I would say address it head on. I think so often we as adults try to cover up the reasons why we are stressed. We try to cover up for kids and we're like, those are big people things. You ain't got to worry about them. Right. But they affect them so much. So I would say hit it head on. And I think there are a lot of YouTube videos that describe what COVID-19 is, what the coronavirus is. For my young people, ages 4 and 2, we literally watched like a cartoon version of what is the coronavirus, what is COVID-19. And so giving them words for their experience allows them to feel the greater sense of clarity of what they're experiencing. I think so often when we don't talk with our young people about things, they are going to make up a story in their head. So you best meet it head on. So I would say sitting down and having conversations with them. I think the other thing I would challenge parents to do is have a schedule for yourself as well as them. Giving too much free time to digital media can either increase the anxiety, because they're going to be, this phrase that I've started using is that entertainment is education. Entertainment is education. If you are entertaining yourself, if you are entertaining yourself with things, you start to believe whatever it is you take in consistently. So if we allow our young people to be on social media for, you know, abnormal amounts of time because they have nothing else to do, or we let them binge watch Netflix specials or whatever the case may be, to allow them just to spend so much time on digital media, one, they're receiving information and we don't know how good that information is. We don't know how accurate that information is. So if you as a parent aren't limiting how much time they spend on the screen, then you won't know exactly what is getting in there. And so I think we must go headstrong into it, like actually have a conversation, don't shy away from it, and then be aware of what free time your children have, and making sure that you also are a part of the media that they're bringing in. Like if you're not sitting down next to them, you won't know what storylines or what information that was coming from. So make sure you're scheduling it, and then make sure you have time with them and not just everybody in their separate corner, you know, receiving information and entertainment from a different box, a different glowing screen.
Right.
So I would challenge parents to do that.
Okay. So like you said, we were talking about addressing the fears in the pandemic. So you want answering the questions. So the kids are going to come with you with questions. So they have to answer them precise and what the parent knows. Don't try making up stuff. I think kids don't like it when you make up things. They want parents to be honest, correct? Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. And what about recognizing the kids' feelings? A lot of times parents, like you had said, you know, this is grown people things, or, you know, only for adults, not for kids. What about recognizing a kid's feelings? Are they actually should be considered with their feelings at this point?
Yes, very much so. I think we as parents have to become feelings detectives. We do it early on in their life, and then we feel like we're let off the hook later in life. So early on, we have to know the difference between a diaper cry or an eating cry or I just want a hug cry. You know what I mean?
Right.
So we're trying to say, are they feeling lonely? Are they hungry? Are they tired?
Right.
But later on in life, because they have acquired language, you assume that when things aren't going well inside of them, that they will say something to you.
They'll say something.
And that's not the case. Right. But that's not the case. You really need to be looking and observing your young person. Attunement is what we call it in the clinical side, where you are tuning into the frequency of what's going on with them, and you're helping label for them the emotions they might be experiencing or the thoughts they might be having. So young people don't know what's going on inside of them sometimes. Sometimes it's so many competing emotions that it just feels like a whole mess on the inside. And so as parents, we have to be able to look at them and say, wow, it could be that you're experiencing this. And then you have to describe for them that emotional state. But when you don't do that, you leave them to just be by themselves. I think we have to recognize the extreme. So the times that our kids are out of sorts, meaning they're just like overreacting, but the times when they're underreacting, like they're just alone, are times that the kids are experiencing a lot of emotion. So I think sometimes when we miss the other side. We miss the other side of the equation when they're just quiet. Because we think, oh, they must be doing fine. No, they're usually quiet. It's because I don't have any words for this, and I don't want to deal with it. And so they're trying to find ways of avoiding their own emotions. And that's the time you also need to come in and talk with them. But again, we as parents need to have gained skills within ourselves of identifying emotions, and then allow those skills to be transferred to our children by helping them label their own experience. I think that that's key. And rather than thinking, you know, young people don't even care, they do. They're taking in so much information that they don't necessarily have words for. And so we as their parents, or we as their guardians, have to be willing to allow them to ask questions. I like how your why or why not is the name of your show. That's the question we hate hearing the most as parents. Well, why? Why not?
Why? Correct. Why not?
But we have to answer those questions. So even my oldest, my 4-year-old, I put her on a 3-why limit.
Okay.
So if she asked me a thing, I'll give the answer. If she says, well, why that? Then I give another answer. Well, why that? I give another answer. And if I do the third one, I'm like, okay, you just got to repeat what you heard me say already. And then we'll get to those others later questioning. But be okay with them asking why at least a few times. Don't just shut down so quickly. I think they are trying to make sense of their world. And if the person who is in charge of their world is not willing to tell them why you're making those choices, then one, they won't be able to trust the choices you're making because you don't have reasons for it. And then two, they won't be able to internalize the choices that you're making because they won't know why you did what you did. So if you give them those whys, those reasons, those purposes, that helps them say, okay, that makes sense as to why you're doing it now. And that makes sense for me to do it later myself.
Correct. Oh, I like that. So definitely talk to the kids and be honest about them and answer those why questions and the why not questions. So we also mentioned about routines, about establishing routines. Because I know even for when we have shelter in place, and heaven forbid we might go back in shelter in place the way things are going in society right now. How can we establish a good routine that works in the household? I know when you work at home, which I assume you work at home during part of that time too, you have the kids in the background, you have the kids that want to play, you have the kids that want to ask why, and the noise. How do we establish a routine even for kids, for them to be? Because we want to establish a routine for us. We got to work, we got to be on the computer at 8:00. But a lot of us, I think parents wind up avoiding the routines for kids. Even as a teacher, I saw kids coming to, the classroom in their pajamas. How can we establish a routine that works for the kids and they understand the purpose of that?
I think key is preparation. So I would challenge all parents to sit down, particularly if they are with their spouse, sit down together and say, okay, what is it that you need to do, blocks of times where you need to have individual time, and then blocks of time that you can share the space with other parts of the family. I think if each person is able to bring forward that, then you can create a system that works for each person in the system. Because young people want time together with parents, want time together with siblings, and then sometimes they need alone time. And so if we take into account the emotional needs of a person, we will make sure to create a schedule that fits everybody, that is a balanced schedule. I would say you want to have your young people have a certain time that they wake up at. You will want to have them a certain time they go to sleep at, because a sleep-wake schedule is key to just managing irritability overall. If you're tired throughout the day, you're going to be irritable throughout the day. So helping a young person realize that just having a schedule is something that's beneficial to the body as well as the mind. I think then finding times for your young person to be creative. And creative. Part of what we can do is, share in the things that allow you to be creative. So if you're a dancer, if you're a singer, if you're an artist or whatever you do that's creative, if you like to do creative things on the computer, allow your young person to see you do it and you do it alongside them. I think that's where we get the movement of our minds. That's when we get those points of connection that allows a young person to feel not just heard, but known and understood, because that's what's going to give them that strength and that support. Our young people gain their identity from those who are around them and who have communicated into their life what it is I see in you. And so if you share and create a moment that allows for your words to, one, sit longer, and it also allows your young person to be able to find things that can relieve them of boredom. Because if there's too much free time, I can't remember the song, but the idle mind is a playground of the devil, you know, kind of thing. Too much free time for a young person leads to just like poor decision making. Mm-hmm. So back to just, you know, schedule things where it's things we can do together, things we can do apart, things that are creative, things that move the mind but are not necessarily school related. So playing a game like a Taboo, it challenges you to use communication skills to win a game. And so you didn't know you were actually educating your child while you were playing Taboo. Didn't know that while you played Catchphrase, you were educating them, or charades. Right. There are so many things that we do. So as a clinical therapist who works at an agency, a residential treatment facility, we have to find ways of making games therapeutic. And it's so much engagement that happens in games. So realizing that you can challenge a skill and develop a skill in a game allows you to, you know, put into your time and put into your schedule those moments of just what it seems like fun, but you're also helping develop skills in that.
Yeah, I do agree we need to have routine. So you're saying kids do need to get up, say like 8 o'clock normal, if school's gonna start at 9, eat breakfast, get dressed, you know, have a routine for chores, have a routine for bedtime and for fun time. Okay, I do agree with that. Anything else they should add on? The social time, that pretty much covers most of the things. Just have that normal routine, like nothing's wrong, like just schedule it, everything on time, correct?
Yeah. I think give time for freedom. Like, definitely don't want to overschedule yourself, because then you'll be trying to have an expectation of young people that will get you irritated. So don't do that. I think making sure you also get outside, I think, is key. So we are a human animal, you know, and we are built for the sun and built for trees and all those things. So getting out and just allowing yourself to be out in nature and not just so focused on our digital world. I think that we are depriving ourselves of something that helps us cope with life. So being outside, being around nature allows you to cope better with all the hustle and bustle. It slows your mind down. It slows your body and your heart rate down so that you actually feel calmer just by being outside and being around things that are natural.
Okay. Well, I know like a lot of parents really don't want their kids interacting with other kids. So like physically being there with other kids, but how can other kids stay communicating or connection with their friends then, outside of actually being in a park or with them?
Yes. So though we have the beauty of this, like we're all across a platform that allows us to talk, even though we're not in the same place, I think that's it does well and allows us to stay connected, but it can't be all that we do. So I know for certain parents who have, let's say, more concerns with the virus and transmission of the virus, having their young people be in close contact with their friends maybe is fear-inducing. But if we all went on a walk and we saw our friends outside without being near each other, that's a way. So finding ways of connecting, even if you can't necessarily be right next to them, I think that's a key piece to staying connected and staying calm and coping well. I think using platforms like this where you're having video as well as voice is good. And you can have prolonged contact and prolonged communication. I think for young people, they are used to text messages or Snapchat or Instagram, where it's like these short snippet, tidbits of conversation that can lead to a lot of miscommunication that happens. So I think challenging young people to not just be engaging through social media, but actually engage on a platform that allows them to have a prolonged conversation about things. I think also doing things, multi-sensory things. So playing, eating meals, even though we're across the screen. So I'm eating maybe even the same meal that another person is eating, right?
We prepare our meals.
Right, which is good. So because what we're missing is that multi-sensory engagement. So when you're right next to a person, you would have that touch, you would have that taste, that smell, all those things. And so if we find ways of doing that together, even like watching, they have like those watch parties. So we're watching the same media at the same time, and then we talk about it afterwards. Just finding ways of connecting and having prolonged communication, not just the you know, you take a snapshot of yourself, I take a snapshot of myself, you text me three words, I text three words back. That's not enough engagement in a conversation. So just, challenging kids to have like longer conversations through like a video platform, I think would be helpful.
Right. And Ashley, I think I'm going to use that advice for my teaching. We're going to be online virtual, our lunch hours. And I think I'm going to arrange for the parents. I have a small class that my kids can actually be online and we could be eating our lunch and talking during that time together. That might actually be pretty nice to do, you know? Can't share the snacks with each other, but we can actually eat all together, you know? Okay. Now, I want to touch back on the mental health of kids. What are some signs that parents can see that their kid, their child, or teenager is having some type of stress or not coping well to COVID or not being in school?
Yeah, I think a big thing would be if they sleep a lot more.
Okay.
If they stop engaging with things that they would otherwise engage in. So if your young person usually talks with you. I'm thinking more of like if your young person used to engage in conversation at the breakfast table and now they're silent.
Oh, okay. Right? Okay.
Then you're like, okay, there's something must be stirring inside of them that I have to go and investigate without grilling, right? So you want to drill without grilling. You want to ask enough questions without making them feel like they're being interrogated. Okay. So I think anytime you see a young person being more withdrawn or not as engaged as they would otherwise be, that's clear that something is going on with them. And I think the other extreme, which most people would see, is when a young person is having more tantrums, yelling, you know, show of emotion. The struggle is there that we don't become reactive to their struggles. So we have to be able to say, they're yelling, they're screaming. What could they be experiencing that is causing that behavior? So rather than yelling at them like, you don't talk to me like that, you need to chill out, all that stuff that we would typically do, we should ask ourselves, okay, I'm gonna reflect what I'm hearing you say. You seem frustrated, but I'm not quite sure why. Help me understand what's frustrating you right now. And then asking those follow-up questions allow for the young people to bring out what they don't even know is in there. So I would think seeing those extremes, either too quiet or too loud, and learning to manage our emotions if they're too loud, so that we can ask the right follow-up questions.
Okay, so definitely pay attention to kids if they're not doing something they used to do. So like if they were talking and now they're quiet and reserved, if they were always out in the living room and now they're in their bedroom, you know, so watch, pay attention to those signs. Okay, that's good. Okay. And I guess even sometimes spouses have to pay attention. Most times spouses have to pay attention to that too, because spouses can actually be having issues with COVID-19 and dealing with this. So we have to pay attention to everyone in the household with them doing different mannerisms, that those change.
Yeah.
Now, with tensions and anxiety being so high, I mean, I know for me, even having someone come in my home for a repair, I'm thinking to myself, that person's going to wear a mask. So kids are going through this. There's frustrations going on. The teachers were upset going back to school, and kids can be asymptomatic and we can get sick. People going back to work. So a lot of frustration in the household. I'm assuming kids can pick up on that. So how do we deal with discipline issues, and how can parents help their children manage their emotions and their behavior in this time? Because kids pick up from us.
Right. So yeah, again, I think going back to that being an emotional detective, like being able to ask the right questions when you see an emotion occurring. So most times we see the emotion as the end all be all, but really it's just a symptom of some kind of thought or frustration inside of them. And so if we're asking follow-up questions like, okay, you're showing an emotion, what was occurring prior to that emotion? If we learn to do that, we'll help them ask questions of themselves. those. Okay. Of like, man, what am I feeling? And if you can mm-hmm. ask yourself what you're feeling, and then ask yourself, why am I feeling that way? I think those questions allow us to think about our thought life, think about that inner experience of the world, mm-hmm. And then find ways of coping with that. So when you're upset, you have to learn how to calm down. And when you're sad, you have to learn to cheer yourself up. So coping mm-hmm. strategies have to fit the emotion that you're experiencing.
Okay.
I think sometimes when you ask young people, hey, you know, what's going on with you? And they only give you three different words, like I'm mad, or I'm sad, or, you know, kids that have experienced too much psychology mm-hmm. out in the mainstream of like, I'm depressed, I'm anxious. Right. Then you're like, okay, well, what do you mean by that? What is your real mm-hmm. experience in the world that is leading to that emotion? So I think mm-hmm. parents have to be aware of their own inner struggles
okay.
so that they can then reflect to their young people what they are also seeing them experience. I think that mm-hmm. each one of those helps the young person cope with this very stressful time. I think that's that. I think the other experience that people have, and you were saying it, is when people are unfamiliar to you, like you're just not used to them, mm-hmm. you already are a little bit scared of what they might bring to you.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're all afraid that there's this hidden invisible force called COVID-19 that anybody could have, and
right.
you may not know if they have it. So we're even more suspicious of one another. And so mm-hmm. we have to challenge that in ourselves. Okay, like I know I'm nervous, but let me just do whatever precautions are necessary and mm-hmm. then still be human. So mm-hmm. for me, when I'm walking around, I may get a point to raise my hand and say hi. Because typically we would maybe mouth hi with your mouth. But if I got a mask on, you can't do it.
Right.
So finding ways of not allowing this time mm-hmm. frame and the precautions that we're all taking to also take away from our humanity. Because, I mean, we speak so much with our facial expressions. And if most of your facial expression is covered by a mask, how can you trust those that are around you? And I think yeah. you have to be active in that and make sure that your words are chosen correctly so that you can really connect with another person like that, and particularly with your young people.
Okay. Well, we only have about a minute left to go on the show. So just a quick 30-second. How would people's faith go along with this? How do people should express their faith to their children through going through this time?
That's good. So our beliefs mitigate our experience, meaning mm-hmm. if I believe a certain thing about the world and other people, it actually changes the way I view them. So if your faith is something that is strong within you or strong to you or valuable for you, it can help you manage the anxieties around you. If you see the world as, you know, going to hell with a handbasket, then you're like, oh, you know, this is just what I'm supposed to expect. Or if you see that, man, humanity is this beautiful animal. I use that phrase of, we can be the best parts of ourselves, even though we can be the worst of ourselves. And then push towards that beautiful nature, right? That image of God kind of thing. So I would just challenge people to realize that your beliefs affect what you see. And so you need to recognize your own faith and your own belief level so that you can, you know, project that for your children and then use that to cope with what you see around you.
Okay, great. I like that. I like that very much. Thank you. Okay, well, today's topic was managing COVID, managing the stress of COVID with teens and children. And we had a special guest here, Anthony Ward Jr. He's an LCPC, a clinical psychologist. You can also look him up on Psychology Today for more information or to contact him. And if you have any questions, please write the show, contact us if you have any suggestions. And thank you very much again, Mr. Ward, for joining us. I appreciate that. Thank you.
And no problem. Have a nice
evening. Thank you. And have a nice evening, everyone. Good night.